Good morning to all of you all. So I'll try and do as much justice as I can by going through various cases that we see, probably we see, but we tend to miss out because we don't think about them. So what's emerging, what's important first to know is that we pediatric infectious disease, it's changing over a period of time. A lot of new diseases, lot of new resistance patterns, lot of new antibiotic failure, so those are things that are coming up. If we look at the drugs, we have lot of new drugs that are coming out in management of pediatric infectious diseases. Especially you have all these monoclonal antibodies now coming up, so you have lot of changes that are taking. We have lot of clinical trials that are coming up which come out with the pharmacokinetic and pharmacokinetic data. So we have drug doses that keep on changing. So we need to be aware, like say for example, INH, we earlier used to give 5 milligram per kg, and now with the new PK data, we are giving 10 milligram per kg. In fact, a lot of my students have been working on this PK data of INH, and I find that in Indian scenario, 5 is less, 10 is more, so we need something which needs to be in between. So we have a lot of these new data. The whole way that we diagnose infectious disease is changing. We are no longer based on ELISA, we are not talking about PCR. And we are now talking about point of care PCRs. So we are not looking at PCRs which give us a report after 1 week. We are talking about PCRs that give us reports in 20 minutes. So we are looking at these kind of multiplex PCRs that are possible in your setup, in your hospital. And we are looking at whole genome sequencing now. So we are talking about not only the human genome, but we are looking at the whole genome of the bacteria. And we are picking up things. So now TB diagnostics is going to change in the next 2 or 3 years. And we'll be out with our DSTs and molecular diagnosis. We'll be talking about whole genome sequencing. So a lot of things changing. Management changes. A lot of ID has now become OPD-based management. Pneumonias that we used to treat for the entire course with IV antibiotics can be treated on OPD basis. A UTI can be treated with an ambulatory basis. You don't need to give IV ceftriaxone or anything for 14 days. You can just send the child home on oral. Osteomyelitis, the one that we used to treat with 6 weeks of IV antibiotics, the child just needs to be given IV for probably 3 or 5 days and then can go home on oral antibiotics, and no longer to give for 6 weeks, you could give the child only 3 weeks. So we have a lot of metadata coming up, we have a lot of Cochrane analysis coming up. It's becoming more and more evidence-based and the way we treat becomes less. I am very bad for my hospitals because I discharge the patients very fast. So that becomes a problem in a corporate setup, but most of the patients don't require to be in the hospital. Say for example, even if you're giving ceftriaxone for enteric fever, you could give them IM. They can go home and take IM every day. You don't need to keep the child in the hospital. So lots of things change. A lot of vaccines are coming up. So we have a new dengue virus vaccine which came out in Southeast Asia, which was recommended for children 9 years and above. And then we have trials on malaria vaccine. We have new TB vaccine trials that are now coming up. Across the globe, we have vaccines for Zika virus, Ebola virus, chikungunya virus. So a lot of new vaccines coming up. So a lot of technological advancement even in that. But then there are old diseases that are coming back. Pertussis is back with a bang. Tuberculosis, measles. So these are the diseases that are coming back. And obviously the multi-drug resistant strains. And India always believes in Make in India. So we have this bug which has been known as the New Delhi bug, and it's a carbapenem resistance, and we have been responsible for the worldwide spread of the carbapenem resistance through medical tourism. We are talking about MDR, XDR TB, we are talking about VRSA, MRSA, pan-resistant gram-negative infections. In my hospital, practically every day I get 10 references from the NICU, PICU and the oncology ward because they don't know which antibiotic to give, and they've isolated some pan-resistant acinetobacter or pan-resistant Klebsiella. I'm sure the same problem must be in various setups here, and this is going to be a major, major problem in the coming years. Drug-wise, we've got newer drugs and we've got older drugs that we've been using. We've used colistin now. Tigecycline, we are using newer drugs like etapenem, doripenem, posaconazole. So a lot of new drugs. Phosphomycin we've been using in children off-label use, and obviously we are back to chloramphenicol. So a lot of things that are now there. So where are we headed in pediatric ID? We've got excellent diagnostics now. We are running out of antibiotics and we've got pan-resistant infections that are now coming up. Now let's go to case scenarios. Case scenarios that we see in our day-to-day practice. So we doctors like to travel. I couldn't follow much in Tamil what was being said, but I do recollect something about some international tour that was being announced before this session started. So we doctors like to travel, and we like to travel to international exotic places, and we Indians are very fidgety. So we like to touch a lot of things. So this is in Sri Lanka, and you can see he's touching the turtle in the turtle farm. So this is an 18-year-old male. He has fever and chills for 3 days. Had diarrhea 1 week prior to the fever, no response to antimalarials. CBC test negative, rapid malaria test negative, urine chest x-ray normal. This is all the places that he's been traveling to. So he's gone to the elephant farm and he's gone to this brackish water. So there's a history of travel 20 days ago to Sri Lanka. He's eaten some street food, done bungee jumping, snorkeling, traveled to wooded areas, visited the brackish waters in a boat but did not swim in that, visited an elephant farm, fed the elephants, baby elephants, visited a turtle farm, touched the turtles. So before I go on to that, does anybody want to think, is it related? Is fever currently related to this?
Maybe.
Could be. So do we ever ask a history in a PEO of history of travel, history of exposure to animals, and history of exposure to unboiled or unpasteurized milk? I think these are the three things that we always need to ask in a history of PEO. History of travel, history of exposure to animals, and history of unpasteurized milk. That would give us a lot of answers rather than working up the child with so many investigations. So can you tell me a common zoonotic disease that you would get from elephants? Out of this list that I have put, can you think of the commonest zoonotic that you would get from elephants? It's tuberculosis. How many of us have pets at home? Are we aware of what disease the pet could get and what could come to us? So there are lots of things. It depends on the kind of pet that we have. We Indians tend to have more domestic animals, but internationally they tend to have reptiles and they have exotic animals as their pets. So you need to be aware. And we're traveling now. So we need to be aware about diseases that occur abroad and which we could come back with. Now from turtles. He's touched the turtles. So can you think of something that he could have got from the turtles? Yes, the non-typhoidal salmonella. All of us go to Chinese restaurants. Chinese restaurants have these turtles in that pond, little pond that they have in the restaurant. And we look at it very gleefully, enjoy it. Sometimes we want to touch it, but we don't realize that they may be harboring non-typhoidal salmonella. For them, it doesn't cause a problem. For us, it may cause just diarrhea. But if you're immunocompromised, you'll just land up like a typhoid. So you may land up with enteric fever. And the risk of zoonosis from a turtle is on this scale of 0 to 10, almost at 7. So this child was actually suspected to have salmonella because he had eaten street food, and non-typhoidal salmonella because he had touched the turtles. And the blood culture grew non-typhoidal salmonella. And how do you treat that? We treat it the same way that we treat typhoid. So if the commonest cause of diarrhea, if you look at the textbooks, they tell you the most common cause of diarrhea, apart from the viruses like rotavirus, norovirus, adenovirus, is basically your non-typhoidal salmonella and E. coli. Shigella is going to become more of dysentery. So we don't really treat these non-typhoidal salmonella until unless they're causing enteric fever. And the treatment is the same as that of a regular typhoid. So you could give quinolone or you could give cephalosporins. So among the pediatric infectious disease, don't forget zoonosis. Children touch things here and there. We don't know what they may be carrying. Hand hygiene is a poor concept in children, and that's why they're going to land up with a lot of zoonosis. The other zoonosis that you have to keep in mind is brucellosis. So always ask for history of unpasteurized milk, okay? Non-typhoidal salmonella, tularemia. I'll tell you an example of a tularemia that I saw. This boy was in the ICU in another hospital, suspected to have dengue fever with dengue shock syndrome. Everything resolved, the platelet counts came up, dengue resolved, but his fever continued up to 104. And then the pediatrician called me up and said his fever is not coming down. So I said there is a chance that there could be a gram-negative sepsis because dengue can make your gut leaky. So just cover him with an antibiotic for the gram-negative bacteria. Let's see after 48 hours. After 48 hours, the fever is still 104, not coming down. So then he requested, can you come down and see the patient? So I went to see the patient. And this patient is running 105, 104 degree fever. The only history that I asked was any exposure to animals. He said, yes, they bought rabbits in their house a month back. So this was tularemia. Tularemia comes from rabbits. The only thing that we gave was doxycycline. Fever resolved in the next 6 hours. So we need to keep this in mind. We are traveling to Europe. We are traveling to America. We need to know about Lyme's disease. This is something that we need to know because we are going to see this. So I had one child who was admitted in Nanavati, 6-month-old child, born in the US, staying near the California forest, had come down to Mumbai and got fever. And we didn't know what the pediatrician was dealing with. When I went and saw the child had a classical erythematous rash on the hand. And because he was from US, we said this is Lyme's. We treated it. We couldn't do the test. We treated it and the child was fine. So a lot of it is going to be travel related, animal exposure, and milk related. Let's go to the next case. 2-year-old girl, she's having fever for 12 days and cough for 15 days. She's been hospitalized, treated with amoxiclav, not responded, given ceftriaxone, not responded. On examination, she's running a fever of 103. There are bilateral Krebs. Investigations are showing leukocytosis with lymphocytosis, her CRP is around 30, blood culture is negative, and she has slightly elevated liver enzymes. So you have this child who's been running fever and cough for almost 12 to 15 days. And this is the X-ray. Anything specific that you see on the X-ray? There's nothing specific that you're seeing. Actually, you're seeing more like a viral picture. There's more of atelectasis, and there's more of straightening of the ribs, hyperinflated chest. So more like a viral picture. Now, why would a virus last for 12 to 15 days? The CRP is non-conclusive. A CRP of 30 does not mean bacterial or viral. It just means inflammation. And the counts are just showing lymphocytosis. So we are headed towards nothing. What would you do here? Shall we screen him for tuberculosis? Because TB is the most endemic thing in our country. Well, we did a multiplex PCR. And what we did, we found was there was mycoplasma and adenovirus. Now, why am I stating this? Why does it help us? We have the biofire machine at our hospital. So we have this multiplex PCR, which we get a pneumonia panel, which looks for 22 organisms at one go. We have a upper respiratory tract panel, which looks at 13 viruses and bacteria. We have a GI panel, which looks at 22 organisms that cause diarrhea. A meningitic panel that looks at all the 18 viruses and all the 3 bacteria. And you have a sepsis panel. The sepsis panel, I really feel, is not very useful because sepsis panel actually works only if the blood culture is positive. It just gives me a diagnosis probably 12 hours earlier. The pneumonia panel has just come out. The problem with the pneumonia panel that I face, because we are doing a study on that, is we've been actually doing the bronchoalveolar lavage in all the critically ill patients. And what we are picking up with the pneumonia panel is we are picking at least 4 bugs. So if I do a BAL, I'll get a streptococcus pneumonia, I'll get an enterovirus, I'll get an adenovirus, and then I'll have some more klebsiella or something. So I'll have 4 bugs growing on that pneumonia panel. I wouldn't know which one is a colonizer, which one is causing the invasive disease. So I'm not sure about how the pneumonia panel will work for hospital-acquired infections, but we'll have to see how it works for community-acquired infections. This was the throat swab. So we've done an upper respiratory tract panel, and this was the 2 things that we found, mycoplasma and adenovirus. I find the diarrhea panel extremely useful in patients with chronic diarrhea. Not for acute diarrhea, but it works very well for chronic diarrhea. Now, this child who had been running fever and cough for 15 days actually had mycoplasma. We have been taught that usually the presentation of mycoplasma is children more than 5 years of age. This child is 2 years. Most infections are self-limited. So the way we have been taught mycoplasma is the child comes with fever, fever subsides and the cough continues. That's how we have been taught about mycoplasma. But you could also have a mycoplasma that goes on with persistent fever and cough. And in auscultation, you just get bilateral Krebs syndrome. So I think the first misconception that we have is mycoplasma is only in children more than 5 years. It occurs at all age. If you look at these PCRs now that we've been doing, we've been picking up mycoplasma in every possible situation. they can come with severe pneumonia, they can come as exacerbation of asthma, encephalitis, hemolytic anemia, renal dysfunction. I've seen mycoplasma coming as pleural effusion. So many times the references come gene expert negative, massive pleural effusion, what to do? Send a mycoplasma. And that's how they are picked up. Stephen Johnson's and another thing. Now, how do we diagnose mycoplasma? Ideal is a culture, but it's time consuming. You're not going to get your result too soon, so we don't really do that. We do serology, so we do the mycoplasma, IgM and IgG. A single test is not specific. You need to have a paired sera, so an acute sample and a convalescent sample, and you have to look for a rising titer. So again, that's not possible. Rising titer means you have to repeat the test after 3 weeks. So it's not the confirmatory test. The confirmatory test is a molecular test, a PCR-based test. Problem, it's not available everywhere, the PCR-based test. And there are only two commercially available kits that have been approved. So there are a lot of these indigenous PCR labs that have now been set up across the country. And I'll come to a PCR-related problem later. But these indigenous labs give you a lot of reports which you don't know how to interpret. So preferably go to a lab that has a kit that is approved by the authorizing agency. So we look at FDA approval. So you look at those kind of PCR tests. So mycoplasma, if you really want to do throat swab, PCR, or you do a blood test, do an ELISA. But ELISA, repeat it after 3 weeks. The problem why the ELISA may be false positive is because the IgM can persist for months together. So you don't know this IgM positive is this infection, or was it that cough 5 weeks back? So you don't know that. That's why you need to do a convalescent and the paired sample. And PCR test, as I told you, you may pick up a PCR, you don't know whether it's invasive organism or it's a colonizer. What's the treatment of mycoplasma? We look at macrolides and tetracyclines. So older children, you can use tetracyclines. Now this child was treated with 5 days of azithromycin, he had no response. What would you do for a macrolide resistant mycoplasma? Yeah, so the other choice is quinolone, so you actually use levofloxacin. So macrolide resistance has been reported in Japan, and the ones that work are fluoroquinolones. So this is something I think all of us need to keep in mind in a patient with a non-resolving pneumonia, viral kind of a picture, and you're not really picking up anything, think of mycoplasma. The other thing that this child had was adenovirus. Now adenovirus in transplanted patients is really a problem. Okay, I just got a call. By the time I'd reached here, I got a call from Tata Hospital. We have a child with febrile neutropenia, running fever, having cough, chest signs, CT's showing some infiltrates. We did this multiplex PCR and we picked up adenovirus. But we don't think it's adenovirus causing the problem because the blood adenovirus is normal in a transplanted child. So anyway, adenovirus, usually we think about it as bronchiolitis obliterans. And we also think adenovirus can spread in the entire body in immunocompromised patients and can cause multi-system organ dysfunction. Cidofovir has been tried in these patients, but in immunocompetent children, it usually doesn't cause a problem. And so do you want to treat this? I wouldn't. So we only treated this child with levofloxacin, the child went home. So we go on to case 3, and this is about the molecular test. Now, HIV diagnosis. HIV is on the downtrend. The epidemic of the last 15 years has really gone down. So HIV is no longer the epidemic that we are worried about now. And Dr. Palaniraman was telling me about talk about different age group presentations of HIV. I thought I'd talk about the most common confusing problem of HIV that we face right now is the diagnosis part of it. We all know that in children, they get maternally transmitted antibodies. So these antibodies are there in the child, and if we do an ELISA, they come positive. So we do PCR tests for children up to 18 months of age, and then after 18 months, we do an ELISA-based test. So this is the same chart. We don't look at cultures, we don't do P24 antigen in children. We only look at ELISAs and we look at PCRs. 1 month-old boy, born to an HIV-infected mother, was referred for further management. Mother was diagnosed at 6 months of gestation. She had received ART for 3 months. Underwent an elective cesarean section, no breastfeeding. However, the child did not receive any antiretroviral drugs. Ideally, the child should have been on nevirapine on cytomodulin prophylaxis. By the time the child had come to us, he was already 1 month of age. So we just examined the child, we found oral thrush. His weight was 3.7 kilo. He was started on cotrimoxazole prophylaxis and was advised regular follow-up. At 3 months of age, he was asymptomatic, and we did his PCR the first time. It came positive. Now, would you call this child HIV infected? Ideally, you never make a diagnosis of HIV based on one test. So you always have to confirm by a positive second report. This is something you're labeling a child for the rest of his life. So you want to be absolutely sure. So at 6 months, again, child is asymptomatic, he's growing very well. His PCR again is positive. So now we have two PCRs that are positive. So is this child infected? Shall we put him on antiretroviral therapy? Till now, we've not put him on that. At 7 months, we didn't believe. We said, how is it possible that this child has... We know all know that if vertically transmitted HIV, it can be devastating in the first year of life. So we did a viral load. Viral load, undetectable. CD4 count, bang, normal. So now what was happening here? Is this child infected? We had no clue. Okay, this was my first presentation that I had seen many years back. But this was absolutely... And subsequently, we've been seeing these kind of reports more and more often. 9 months, we first did his ELISA. You know, the maternal antibodies can start disappearing from 6 months onwards, up to 18 months, sometimes even 24 months. So we first did an ELISA at 9 months, which was negative. 18 months, child asymptomatic, gaining weight adequately. ELISA negative, Western blot negative. So now, would you say this child was HIV infected or not? Probably this child was not HIV infected. We very categorically told the parents he's HIV negative. Can you imagine the mental trauma that these parents must have gone through when they heard those reports, initial reports of positive, positive, positive? And we were not ready to start treatment at that time. So this was the first time that we saw this patient. Subsequently, we've been seeing a lot of these false positive HIV PCRs positive, and we found that sensitivity 100%, but specificity is 57%. So 50% of our patients with an HIV PCR positive were actually negative. And why was this occurring? Because this was an era in which we didn't have these PCR labs that had formed, but these commercial labs were doing these PCRs. So I went to each and every lab which was doing this PCR in the city of Mumbai to see how they were doing the PCR. Now, ideally, if you look at the books, they tell you PCR is the gold standard, and you're supposed to use these standardized PCR kits which don't have contamination taking in the lab. So the standard PCR kit is going to cost me 8,000 rupees per test, which is not viable. So what these labs do is they'll get the primers of the PCR for a particular region. So in HIV, they'll get for the envelope region or the gag region or the pol region. They'll amplify that particular region with those primers, run the PCR, and then read the PCR on colorimetry or whichever method they're using and give us a report. So everything is manual. There's chances of contamination. And you'll get a report for 1,500 rupees. But that report may not be reliable. And that's exactly the problem currently with all these PCR labs that have come up in the country, who are running these PCRs indigenously devised, which are not FDA approved or any agency approved, and you don't know how to interpret these reports clinically. So be very careful when you're asking for a test, because you don't know how to interpret it. If it fits into your clinical situation, yes. If it doesn't, and parents go through that trauma, you have no answers for these reports. So please be very careful. So this was one problem with the PCR that I've been telling you. Now PCR is being done by NACO at their centers, at various centers, and they're doing dried blood spot. When NACO meeting I had gone for, and this early infant diagnosis was put across, I told them, this is the problem we saw when we were doing this. Are you going to face this problem? So they said, no, they will not face this problem because they will train their technicians in the correct way. They have this problem in NACO and they call it as discordant. Okay? So they'll get a PCR positive and subsequent ELISA negative. They'll call this as discordant report, put the child on ERT, and then when that ELISA comes negative at 18 months, they'll stop the ERT. So there is a difference there, but this problem is definitely there. So when you get this report and you will see this, what you're going to see in HIV, you're not going to see now varied presentations of HIV. HIV epidemic has gone down. The time was there when I used to see 60 patients per OPD, and now a time is there where I see 15 patients of HIV per OPD. It's really gone down. Pediatric HIV is going down. So what HIV we are going to see is now MDR HIV. The patients who are failing their treatment. I remember going to Kolhapur for a conference. On the way, I had to stop at Panchgiri to go to a hospital, Red Cross Hospital. That's the only hospital in this Maharashtra which caters to HIV-infected children and adults. And they admit all these patients who are referred from nearby towns. when I went there for a visit, I saw cryptococcal meningitis and I saw different kinds of Kaposi sarcomas, and I told them, this is what we used to see 10 years back. We don't see this now in the era of antiretroviral therapy. And why are you seeing all this now? And you have 10 patients of HIV admitted at one time in the hospital. That's just not possible. You could hardly have one admission of HIV now. They don't require admission. Treatment failure because of non-compliance. That's going to be an issue coming up. So we're going to see a lot of MDR HIV, and we're going to see a lot of now treatment compliance issues. So you're not going to see new pediatric HIV coming vertically transmitted. You're going to see these problems. So shall we go on to TB now? Okay. The question that was put to me is, are we underdiagnosing TB? And I would say, are we overdiagnosing TB? Okay, so we are going to talk about this. 2.5-month-old boy, fever and breathlessness for a month. There's a contact with an adult having TB. Chest x-ray showed obstructive emphysema on the left side. CT chest showed a large node, which was causing that emphysema, and a gastric lavage showed AFP on the smear. Gene expert was positive, HIV ELISA was negative. Initially, he was started on HRZE because gene expert showed RIFA sensitive, but then culture grew resistant bug. It was resistant to all the first lines, HRZES and Oflox and Moxiflox. So it was like a pre-XDR TB, and then he was started on second line AKT. After 2 months of starting second line AKT, his weight had increased by 1 kilo, and we did a routine ophthalmological examination and we found a tubercle. So because we found a tubercle in the eye, we did a CNS thorough examination. We found wrist reflexes and extensor plantars. And we did a CT brain, which showed cerebral and cerebellar tuberculomas with enhancing exudates. So now we have a drug-resistant TB who's worsening on your treatment, though not clinically, but on your examination, he has worsened. So is this worsening TB? This is something we all take as worsening, but actually it's a paradoxical reaction. It's something known as iris, that you see in HIV, immune reconstitution syndrome. It's similar to that which we call as paradoxical reaction. Because of the immune response, there is a flaring of a tubercle or a lymph node. It enlarges, the child may get fever, a pleural effusion. You think it's worsening. It just needs treatment with steroids. So keep this in mind when you're treating patients with TB and they get a lymph node while on treatment, or they get a pleural effusion while on treatment, or they get a tuberculoma on treatment, it does not mean that it was drug sensitive and now it's drug resistant. It may just mean that it's paradoxical. How do we prove that? Child is putting on weight, child has a good appetite. That's one indicator. And second, you may have to do a culture and prove it's culture negative. That's another way of proving it. So this child was just given steroids and he's doing very well. So this is one aspect of TB that we all need to keep in mind. Now, some things that we see in the ICU, but some things that may come to you in community acquired practice. This was a 4.5-year-old boy. He had watery diarrhea with mucus and blood. His stool test was Clostridium difficile antigen positive, and he was referred for his management of Clostridium. Now, you'll wonder, why would somebody do a Clostridium difficile in a community acquired diarrhea? This is just like a dysentery, watery diarrhea with blood and mucus. This could just be Shigella. Why would somebody do a Clostridium difficile? So let's go into his history. He was actually resident of UK, and his father was a doctor in the NHS system, and he wanted his son to be brought up in India. So he had sent the son to Aurangabad to his grandparents to be brought up. Now when he came from UK to India, in the first month after arrival, he had a throat infection. This time he was treated with amoxiclav for 10 days. Second month he had a diarrhea, he was treated with cefixim and metronidazole. Fourth month he had a throat infection, again given amoxiclav for 10 days. Fourth month after the throat infection he had a diarrhea, so treated with ciproflox, norflox, tinidazole. And the current episode was diarrhea with blood. Don't we do this? We are laughing right now, but we do exactly this. Okay, and how do you think he landed up with Clostridium difficile? So now when this episode occurred, the father flew down from UK, London, came down in a huff and a puff. So they did all tests and they did Entamoeba histolytica, Giardia, Cryptosporidia, everything came negative, stool culture came negative, so they did a stool Clostridium difficile. Now what's the predisposing factor for a C. difficile? So it's all of these antibiotics, and which one do you think is the most common? We always think of clindamycin as the commonest, but I tell you it's more of cephalosporins, and we use this left, right and center. When I was in the UK and going for the ID rounds in the hospital, I remember even in an ICU to start ceftriaxone, the ICU in charge had no say over that. If we get a call in the ICU that this so-and-so child is admitted, we need to start an antibiotic. The ID round used to consist of an ID specialist, a microbiologist, and a pharmacologist. All of us used to go to the ICU, review the papers, discuss it out, and decide whether the child needs ceftriaxone or not. That's the way the practice used to be. So this is how it used to be. Cefixim is not allowed to be used by any doctor in the UK until unless they get permission from the NHS. So he was furious, this doctor was furious, and he said, how could anybody prescribe cefixim just like that? So he brought the child here, and then which test do we do for diagnosis of Clostridium difficile? We do the toxin. So you do ask for a toxin, basically. PCR test will not tell you whether it's active or it's colonizer. And how do you treat Clostridium difficile? Yeah, Metro is one, but if you had to give vancomycin? You're supposed to give oral vancomycin. So your IV vancomycin will not work. The same IV can be given orally. Okay, so you need to give oral vancomycin. The treatment is basically stop the antibiotic. For the primary treatment, give metronidazole. For serious or complicated, you give oral vancomycin. And if only IV is an option, then you have to give IV metronidazole. This child was given oral metronidazole. He was fine. Now the father was extremely anxious. He did a PCR after 5 days of these antibiotics, and the PCR was positive, the toxins had become negative. Now what do you do? The PCR will remain positive because Clostridium difficile is there in our GI tract, so it doesn't matter. You need to know whether it's active or not, so you look at the toxin production. So there is no need to treat that PCR positive. I think if we actually looked at community acquired Clostridium difficile, we'll pick up a lot. And this is what I do in the NICU when I get a reference from the NICU. Child is responding and now has this, and now the child is having diarrhea. The first thing the neonatologist will think is CMV and send a CMV PCR. And the first thing when the call comes to the ID, they think of Clostridium difficile. So we send the toxin. So you should suspect Clostridium difficile diarrhea even in community acquired infections if somebody has been receiving antibiotics for more than a week. And how do you prevent that? Hand washing. How many of y'all wash your hands between the patients? One person. With soap and water or with an alcohol rub? Alcohol rub. How much time do you keep that alcohol rub on your hands? I don't think we spend more than 5 seconds. We are in so much rush. It's like this. Even in the ICU when I go, the residents show me, remove the blanket. That's the way. This is exactly the time that they take to wash their hands. It's ideally supposed to be 20 seconds. 20 seconds is good enough time to remove it. And you have to go between the webs of your fingers, between the thumbs, the back of your hands. That takes 20 seconds. I don't think we teach this. And when nothing works, no antibiotics works, this is the only thing that works in the NICU and PICU, hand washing. Isolate the patient, hand washing, that's it. So infections in children are challenging, especially PUO. Newer diagnostics, approach with clinical correlation, and rational antibiotic use and antibiotic stewardship is the need of the hour. Now we talk about TB. 12-year-old girl, bilateral posterior cervical lymph nodes, 1.5 centimeter in size for 10 days. No fever, no contact with TB, no response to antibiotics. Mantoux is negative, ESR is 50, chest x-ray is normal. Pediatrician told them we need an FNAC, parents not ready for FNAC. Should we start treatment? How do we go? Wait, but they are very worried about those lymph nodes. Posterior cervical lymph node. How common is TB in the posterior cervical lymph node? We usually look at anterior, submandibular and anterior. We don't look at other things, head lice. This child actually had head lice. And it was just treatment of the head lice. So the most common cause of a cervical lymphadenopathy, first thing, ask for history of head lice. We don't ask that. In children, it's extremely common. So some things is just common sense. It's just common. I think as doctors, we've gone so much into invasive technology that we've forgotten common sense. And this is what we land up doing. 2.5-year-old boy, pain in abdomen for 7 days. no fever, no bladder wall complaints, we land up with strain and ultrasound. And ultrasound obviously shows these mesenteric nodes, and largest is 1 centimeter. So the next step is to do a Mantoux test, which comes positive, HIV ELISA negative, and now the reference comes to you, please start TB treatment in this patient. Have you all done something like this? If you tell me no, you're lying. Okay, because I get this kind of a reference at least 3 or 4 times in a week. And do you think this child has TB? How do you explain the positive Mantoux? 10 TU. Okay, so what is the ideal TU that we are supposed to use? 1 to 2 TU. What about 5? In Mumbai, we don't get 1 to 2, we get 5. So there are two types of Mantoux. You get PPD-S or you get 1 to 2, which is tween 80 RT 23 PCR. So if you have that tween 80 RT 23 PCR, you're supposed to use this 1 to 2 TU. But if you just get a plain PPD-S without the tween 80, you have to use 5 TU. Did you understand the point what I'm trying to do? What is tween 80? Tween 80 is a detergent. And the PPDS is a standardized purified protein derivative. That's how Mantoux was first discovered. Now, why that tween 80 was added? Because earlier we used to use these glass syringes. So these tuberculin, you would stick to the glass syringe. So if you were putting 0.1, half of it would remain in the glass syringe. So that it was no point. So they started adding tween 80. Now the whole thing would go. So they find if you add tween 80, 1 to 2 is enough to give you a positive report. If you use a higher, say 5 or 10 of tween 80, you'll end up with a false positive one. But if you're still using the good old PPDS, then you need a 5 TU. So that 5 TU PPDS is equivalent to 1 TU of tween 80, 23. Now we come to the role of IGRAs. Now this child had a positive Mantoux. Can we do an IGRA? Now what is a quantiferon TB goal? You know, we have actually thrown this IGRA into the dustbin saying it's not to be used for diagnosis of TB. Why don't we throw Mantoux also into the dustbin saying it's not to be used for diagnosis of TB? It's only for diagnosis of latent TB. Your Mantoux does not tell us active versus latent. So I think we are misusing our Mantoux and we are picking up over-diagnosing a lot of TB. Before we throw IGRA into the dustbin, let us understand the concept of an IGRA. What is an IGRA? It's a quantiferon release assay. So what it does is you give a same principle as Mantoux. Mantoux, you're giving a PPDS. You're looking for release of interferon gamma in the system. And then you're looking at the induration, delayed hypersensitivity. What is IGRA? You remove the blood of the patient. You add the TB antigen, you look for release of interferon gamma, you get a value objective, and then you say whether it's positive or negative. So it's the same principle. The antigen is different. In TB, we are using PPDS, PPD, purified protein derivative. In IGRA, we are using a different antigen, which is your ESAT-6 and the CFP. Now, what are the difference in the antigens? PPDS is cross-reactive. So it's common for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, it's common for BCG, it's common for non-tuberculous mycobacteria. So positive Mantoux can be because of BCG, it can be because of environmental mycobacteria, it can be because of MTB. Your IGRA, I'm using a protein, the antigen which is very specific for MTB. So my positive IGRA is only because of MTB, it cannot be because of the others. It's that simple an explanation. So if I do an IGRA positive, I know this child is harboring the bacillus of MTB. Whether it's causing a disease or not, I do not know. Okay, so that's the advantage of an IGRA. That child was definitely not TB, so we didn't do an IGRA in this patient. 10 TU, nodes were non-necrotic, I'll just go back to that. Nodes were non-necrotic, so this is not TB. Okay, TB nodes are necrotic nodes, caseous nodes. So you look at this kind of a thing. This is a 7-year-old boy, dry cough for a month. No fever, no loss of weight, no loss of appetite. He's had a contact with a neighbor who had TB. Mantoux was 13 millimeter, chest x-ray is normal, ESR is 5. Now what do you do? You have a child who's had a contact with a neighbor, you have a Mantoux positive, and he's having dry cough. I would definitely rule out active TB in this child. But first I would rule out whether this Mantoux positive is false positive or not. So we did a quantiferon gold test that came negative. So that tells me this Mantoux positive was probably BCG or non-tuberculous mycobacteria. So how does this Quantiferon TB Gold help me? It didn't help me to make a diagnosis of TB. It helped me to rule out TB. So that's the advantage of doing this test. Government of India is going to roll out identification of latent TB in high-risk population very soon. We are talking about elimination of TB. You know, the Prime Minister of our country has said that we'll work towards elimination of TB by the year 2025. So if we are talking about elimination, we also have to remove this latent pool from the country. This latent pool, if everybody, if I did a Manto of this audience here, 90% of us would be Manto positive. That means, are we all latent TB? Probably not, because all of us are exposed to environmental mycobacteria. It's there in the water. So if we just wash our hands, probably we've got environmental mycobacteria. So how do we prove that? We do the Quantiferon TB Gold. Can we do it in the entire population? Not possible, too costly. So we do it in high risk, all contacts of active TB. Start screening them. So that's the way this will help us. So this is going to come out. It's not going to be a test which has to be discarded.